Welcome to the webinar series of Stolz Medical. Today is already the 8th webinar of our series. The topic today is current evidence of conservative therapy in Achilles tendinopathy. The speaker, Dr. Martin Ringeisen, is an experienced user of shockwave devices and is General Secretary for DIGEST. DIGEST is a German-speaking international society for extracorporeal shockwave therapy. They have been responsible for setting standards in the education of shockwave users in the last decades. In this ESWT live webinar, Dr. Ringeisen will discuss all different therapy strategies for Achilles tendinopathy according to the current evidence-based literature. After the presentation, you will have the chance to ask questions by the chat function of the webinar. Please note, the webinar will be recorded as a special service to our customers. The recording of all the webinars are available on the shockwaveportal.com. If you are not yet registered, please ask your local dealer. We already had a great lineup of interesting topics brought to us by experts. The previous webinars were given by Professor Dr. Knoblauch, Professor Dr. Gerdesmeier, Dr. Beetje, Dr. Swart and Di Maio, Professor Carlos Leal, and Paul Oberow. As you can see, more webinars are coming in the next coming weeks. Now I'm happy to hand over to Dr. Ringeisen. Enjoy the presentation. Martin, the stage is yours.
Okay, Olaf, thank you very much for the kind introduction. I appreciate being here and I just want to say some words to my person. I am located in Augsburg, which is in southern Bavaria in Germany. Augsburg is Germany's third oldest city and was founded in 1500 before Christ by the Romans. This picture shows the city hall of Augsburg, which was built from 1615 until 1624 by Elias Holl. One of the more important details of local history is that the European banking system was dominated by the patrician families Fugger and Welser in the 16th century. This picture shows Augsburg's Maximilian Street. It is one of the city's most historic streets. In 2019, UNESCO recognized the water management system of Augsburg as a World Heritage Site. We have a university hospital, and as well, we have a special clinic for orthopedic surgery that was founded in 1868 by Court Counselor Sir Friedrich Hesse. The Hessing Clinic contains 320 beds and includes every specialty of orthopedic surgery. This clinic was where I got my orthopedic education in the early 90s, focused on spine surgery and endoprosthetics. In the center of Augsburg, I have my own private office focusing on regenerative methods, especially shockwave therapy. I conducted my first shockwave therapy in May 1998. Since 2014, I've been General Secretary of the German Society of Shockwave Therapy, DIGEST. In this function, I coordinated a new 60-hour educational course for shockwave therapy, and I'm also a member of the ISMST. The object of my talk today is to explore the evidence of every conservative therapy option in Achilles tendinopathy according to the literature. As you all know, Achilles tendinopathy is one of the most common overuse problems in sports medicine. It is affecting athletes as well as sedentary persons. The term tendinopathy indicates an overuse condition in around the tendon. Histopathological assessment is required to distinguish degenerative changes without inflammatory features in sense of tendinosis or inflammatory process in sense of tendinitis. In pathogenesis, we differentiate intrinsic and extrinsic risk factors. Intrinsic factors could be anatomical and biomechanical factors like overpronation of the foot and muscular imbalance. Extrinsic factors include sports equipment and training errors, but also systemic diseases like diabetes, hypercholesterolemia, or rheumatologic diseases can cause tendon disorders. Fluoroquinolones have a high risk for tendon damage, specifically acute Achilles tendon ruptures, as could be demonstrated in many papers, like this one from Fernandez Cuadros. For me, one of the most outstanding experts in tendon pathologies is Mr. Lukas Weisskopf from Rheinfelden in Switzerland, who has published the book The Tendon in 2017. And I thank Carsten Knobloch, who introduced me to Lukas Weisskopf. And Carsten also wrote a chapter in this book about sclerosing therapy in tendon disorders. I will go into this in more detail later. Mr. Weisskopf modified the tendinosis cycle for Mr. Leadbetter in the following sense. An overuse injury leads to tendon degeneration. Due to an inadequate matrix synthesis, it comes to an increasing matrix degeneration, which declares the tendinosis cycle as an incomplete healing response. The increasing matrix degeneration leads to microruptures, tendon deterioration, and finally to partial or complete ruptures. The idea that tendinopathy is a failed healing response was also published by Mr. Fu in 2010 as a three-stage model. The injury trigger leads on the basis of a failed healing to various manifestations of tendinopathy. When we talk about Achilles tendinopathy, we have to differentiate between the insertional and the mid-portion area. The insertional tendinopathy occurs at the bone tendon junction, and the non-insertional tendinopathy occurs more proximally in the mid-portion, which is an area of poor blood supply. The entirety of conservative options can be apportioned in three stages. Stage one are the standard options, stage two, the device-based therapies, and stage three, the injection therapies. So we want to start with the stage one, the standard options. Therapy starts always with the explanation. Sorry, it was too fast. Therapy starts always with the explanation about tendon disorders and the importance to avoid the injury triggers. That means activity modification in a higher sense. If we look to the standard options, the most evidence-based literature can be found about eccentric load. The first author who defined the term eccentric loading was Mr. Erling Asmussen in 1953 in his paper Positive and Negative Muscular Work. It became more famous later with a study by Hakan Alfredsson about eccentric training in Achilles tendinopathy. The classic eccentric loading is based on this prospective study by Alfredsson in 1998. He treated 15 recreational athletes for 12 weeks with eccentric loading and found out that all 50 patients were back at their pre-injury level with full running activity. Alfredsson described a significant decrease of pain during activity and a significant increase of calf muscle strength on the injured side. And this is the original Alfredsson protocol. For 12 weeks, two times a day, on 7 days of the week, patients have to do three sets with 15 repetitions. After some weeks, patients can force these exercises by adding a weight in a backpack. But now we want to take a look at the literature. Mr. Rowe researched the conservative management of mid-portion Achilles tendinopathy in a systematic review and found in 47 included studies strong evidence for eccentric loading, moderate evidence for splinting and bracing, limited evidence for orthosis and therapeutic ultrasound. In addition to that, he found no data for taping techniques. Also, Mattia Lupini and Nicola Maffulli found excellent clinical results of eccentric loading with no reported side effect in a literature review published in the Journal of Muscles, Ligaments and Tendons in 2012. Beside eccentric loading, there's a more recent option called heavy slow resistance training. This training involves using high loads upon the tendon, such as 70 to 85% of one repetition maximum. As you can see, the heavy slow resistance protocol takes less time than the eccentric loading protocol. It's just three times a week for 12 weeks. But how does heavy load resistance perform in evidence-based literature? ARCT by Vicky Bayer and Mats Kongsgaard, published in 2015, compared eccentric loading, exercise, and heavy slow resistance training in 58 patients. Both groups had 12 weeks treatment. They found significant improvement in both groups regarding the Weiser A questionnaire and the VAS score. Mr. Heitkamp explored different options of calf muscle training. He saw good evidence for the same effect by using eccentric training and heavy slow resistance training. So these are the most recommendable types of calf muscle training. But what about orthosis and splinting? A systematic review by Mr. Wilson, published in 2018, included 22 studies with 1,137 patients. This review explored the effect of exercise, orthosis, and splinting for treating Achilles tendinopathy. And here are his results. He found a moderate level of evidence for eccentric loading over control. He found moderate level of evidence of no significant difference between eccentric exercise and heavy slow resistance training. He found a high to moderate level of evidence of no benefit by orthosis and no benefit adding a splint to an exercise program. The next topic in stage one is acupuncture. There's only a little evidence-based literature. There's just one RCT regarding acupuncture versus eccentric exercise. It includes 64 patients aged from 18 till 70. Results show improvement in both groups regarding Weiser A questionnaire and VAS score, but in this study, acupuncture was superior to eccentric exercise. A systematic review from 2016 about effectiveness of acupuncture therapies in tendinopathies found only inconsistent evidence for the effectiveness of acupuncture. The last topic in the first stage of therapies is nutrition, or how we say nutraceuticals. I would like to present you two reviews that explore the help of oral supplementation. The first literature review by Carlo Loiacano is published in 2019. He summarized that the results of many clinical studies are biased as multiple substances were included in the same formulation and poor methodology was adopted. For these reasons, no definitive recommendations on the use of nutraceutical supplementation can be given. Another systematic review published in the Journal of Muscles, Ligaments and Tendons in 2016 considered the most frequent used substances for supplementation in tendinopathies, like, as you can see here, glucosamine, chondroitin, vitamin C, type 1 collagen and bromelains also, as well as curcumin, boswellic acid, and methylsulfonylmethane. Also, these authors saw biased results because in most of the studies, more than one supplement was administered at the same time. So at least a definitive recommendation of the use of nutraceutical supplementation could not be published. So if we summarize the results from stage one, the most evidence is in eccentric loading and heavy slow resistance training. So we move forward to stage two, the device-based therapy options in Achilles tendinopathy. And here we start with extracorporeal shockwave therapy. Overall, we have 121 evidence-based studies about shockwave therapy in Achilles tendinopathy. For me, one of the most outstanding papers is a review by Ludger Gerdesmeier, published in 2015 at the International Journal of Surgery. In this review, Ludger Gerdesmeier enrolled 6 RCTs. 5 RCTs demonstrated positive outcome 1B, that means best evidence. I would like to present one of these 5 studies with positive outcome. It is published by Jan de Grompe and compares eccentric loading versus eccentric loading plus shockwave therapy in 68 patients. Grompe found out that eccentric loading alone is less effective than in combination with shockwave therapy. A review by Magdalena Stania from 2019 included 22 studies regarding shockwave therapy for Achilles tendinopathy. This review confirmed another time the effects of shockwave therapy. Shockwave therapy does not induce rapid symptom improvement. Rather, it initiates regenerative processes within injured tissues. The effectiveness was not assessed immediately after the completion of shockwave therapy, but several weeks or months later. Recapitulating the results of this review, shockwave therapy is a safe, well-tolerated treatment modality and shows beneficial effects. But if we talk about the effects of shockwave therapy, I want you to remember how shockwave therapy works in tendon tissue. One of the first studies that demonstrated the effects of shockwave therapy in sense of a biological response, or as we say, mechanotransduction, was published by Professor Wang in Taiwan. The right limbs of 50 New Zealand rabbits received 500 impulses of shockwave with 0.18 millijoule near to the tendon bone junction. The left limbs received sham treatment. The biopsies were performed in both groups at 0, 1, 4, 8, and 12 weeks with 10 rabbits at each time period. Professor Wang detected a significant increase of neovascles after 4 and 8 weeks, and that peak remained over 12 weeks. Same like neovascles were the effects for endothelial nitric oxide synthase, also for vascular endothelial growth factor, and for proliferating cell nuclear antigen. As you can see, there's a time-dependent effect with increasing factors after 4 and 8 weeks. So the result that is time-dependent effect was very important to see the working mechanism from shockwave therapy. Together with other cell studies, we can summarize that shockwave therapy in Achilles tendon tissue shows following effects. It reduces inflammatory signs like swelling, like edema, like inflammatory infiltration. It stimulates cell growth and collagen synthesis. It decreases the expression of pro-inflammatory cytokines and normalizes the alignment of the collagen nanostructure and also stimulates the vasculogenesis. And here are some examples for clinical application. The first patient is a professional athlete. She was the German master in high jumping. She had a severe mid-portion tendinopathy with pain over 1 year and several conservative therapies without shockwave. She had a partial rupture, as you can see in this photo. And I treated her according to the guidelines, and she was completely pain-free after 3 months and had a good return to sport also. A control MRI after 5 months showed a complete healing of the tendon. The next case is a female sports teacher and running athlete with a mid-portion tendinopathy. She also recovered from pain and disability after shockwave therapy, and a control MRI shows healthy Achilles tissue in the non-insertional area. And here are the standard therapy settings according to the guidelines ISMST and Digest. We do 3 to maximum 5 treatments with an energy flux density regarding the focused technique from 0.10 till 0.25 millijoules per square millimeter in an interval from 1 to 2 weeks. According to the radial technique, we take an energy flux density from 2 till 4 bar, a frequency to maximum of 10 hertz. And in radial technique, we do 2,000 to 3,000 impulses per treatment. And as you can see in focused technique, we do 1,500 to 2,500 impulses per session. We don't use local anesthesia, and we use ultrasound JLS for coupling. So, next point is extracorporeal magnetotransduction therapy, so-called EMTT. Ludger Gerdesmeier introduced me to this new technique, and I'm working with it since November 2015. A couple of weeks before, there was a webinar with Ludger Gerdesmeyer about EMTT, and I would like to repeat the most important details for this device. EMTT differs from conventional pulsed electromagnetic field systems due to a high oscillation frequency of 100 to 300 kilohertz. A deep tissue penetration up to 18 centimeters is possible. The magnetic field strength is up to 80 millitesla and shows an effective field range that is 4 times higher than regular pulsed electromagnetic fields. Next slide demonstrates the oscillating impulse of EMTT. One oscillating impulse takes about 140 microseconds. The oscillation frequency is about 100 to 300 kilohertz, and the oscillations per pulse are more than 15. The effects of pulsed electromagnetic fields in vitro are ascertained as significant reduction of pro-inflammatory cytokines, increasing neovasculogenesis, release of growth factors, improvement of blood supply, and reduction of pain and disability. The indications for extracorporeal magnetotransduction therapy are indeed every indication of a classical patient in an orthopedic office, like bone tissue pathologies and sense of stress fractures, bone marrow edemas, non-unions or delayed fracture healing, as well as contralateral tissue pathologies in sense of osteoarthrosis of joints, but also myofascial pain, tendinopathies, insertional tendinopathies like greater 200 pain syndrome or Achilles tendinopathy are possible indications, and also degenerative spine diseases as well. And there's a prospective study by Ludger Gerdesmeyer concerning EMTT in Achilles tendinopathy. 53 patients were enrolled for 8 treatments. At the 12-week assessment, the therapy group had significantly improved visual analog scale scores in compared to the control group. Another RCT explored the effect of EMTT in low back pain. Two groups with non-specific low back pain were either treated with conventional therapy alone over 6 weeks or in combination with 8 sessions of EMTT. The combination of EMTT and conventional therapy proved significantly superior to the conventional therapy alone. This study by Tim Klüter and Ludger Gerdesmeyer explored the effect of EMTT in combination with shockwave therapy versus shockwave therapy alone in cases of rotator cuff tendinopathy. They enrolled 86 patients in this prospective randomized trial. The combination of EMTT and shockwave therapy produced significantly greater pain reduction in the visual analog score and better function in constant Mercalli score. I believe that EMTT could be potentially a useful modality for the treatment of musculoskeletal disorders. The next topic in stage 2 is low-level laser therapy. Currently, we have a total of 37 studies about low-level laser therapy concerning Achilles tendinopathy published. Low-level laser has a variety of alternate names, including low-power laser, soft laser therapy, low-intensity laser therapy, low-energy laser therapy. We differentiate hard laser with energy levels between 30 until 180 watt for surgery, mid-laser with binary milliwatts, and low-level laser with low milliwatt emission. Low-level laser therapy is a therapy with light waves. Those light waves stimulate the mitochondrial activity. Thereby, it comes to an activation of transcription factors, and that leads to an activation of cell mobility, cell motility, and growth factor production. I thank Carsten Knobloch for this slide. A systematic review and meta-analysis by Mr. Tumulty included 25 RCTs regarding low-level laser therapy in tendinopathy. He observed good results with strong evidence in 12 RCTs and found that in those studies, dosage recommendations were given. 13 RCTs showed inconclusive or no effect. Mr. Tumulty concluded that positive outcomes are associated with the use of dosage recommendations. Another study by Mr. Stergiolas in 2008 included 25 recreational athletes. He matched low-level laser therapy with eccentric exercise versus eccentric exercise with placebo low-level laser therapy. This randomized control trial with evidence level 1 could demonstrate that low-level laser therapy accelerates clinical recovery from chronic Achilles tendinopathy when added to an exercise program. A narrative literature review by Mr. Balzer included 25 studies and showed also low-level laser therapy as an effective, non-invasive, safe, and cost-efficient means to treat musculoskeletal conditions. So if we summarize all the therapy option of stage 2, the device-based therapy, there's excellent evidence at ESWT, there's a moderate evidence at low-level laser therapy, and there's a new promising option with EMTT that showed significant good results in a prospective study regarding Achilles tendinopathy. So now we step forward to stage 3, the injection therapies. The first time that autologous blood therapy was published in literature was in 1960. Mr. Schulte reported about the filling of bone defects with autologous blood after oral surgery. During the years, the meaning of thrombocytes and their containing growth factors was detected. So autologous blood developed more and more to platelet-rich plasma. Starting in 1997, the first commercial products for PRP were on the market. PRP is made of anticoagulant autologous blood. Dependent on the centrifugation technique, you can get different types of PRP, like leukocyte poor or leukocyte rich. Leukocytes are containing pro-inflammatory cytokines like TNF-alpha and interleukin-1-beta. The effect of PRP in vitro demonstrated a large number of regenerative effects, like an increase of cell proliferation, collagen synthesis, and angiogenesis. But the results in vivo are not the same. We start with a meta-analysis of 7 RCTs exploring the effect of autologous blood products, including PRP, in Achilles tendinopathy, published in 2018 by Mr. Lin. All RCTs matched autologous blood products versus sham injection or no injection or physiotherapy alone. So he found out that there was no difference between using PRP in Achilles tendinopathy or placebo group. Mr. De Jonge investigated a 1-year follow-up of PRP in chronic Achilles tendinopathy in a double-blinded RCT with 45 patients. Receiving either PRP or saline injection added to eccentric exercise program, the results showed no clinical and ultrasonographical superiority of PRP over placebo injection. Same if the He compared PRP versus saline injection in 54 patients combined with eccentric loading. Results showed that PRP compared to saline did not cause greater improvement in pain and activity. Meta-analysis by Mr. Tang from 2018 also found no superiority in PRP injections versus saline injections regarding 4 RCTs. So we can see that there's a big discrepancy in PRP between in vitro and in vivo studies. This may be mainly due to the lack of standard PRP preparation procedures or methods of applications. Still, there is no clear first-line option for PRP in tendon disorders regarding Achilles tendinopathy. And now we step forward to sclerosing therapy. The injection of sclerosing agent polidocanol is target-oriented to neovessels. And indeed, there are a few papers that demonstrate good effects for polidocanol in prospective studies. The first study by Åberg and Alfredsson enrolled 10 patients in a prospective study with chronic painful mid-portion tendinopathy. After an average of 2 injections, there was a significant reduction of pain and no remaining neovascularization. Also, a 2-year follow-up by Lind and Alfredsson showed a significant reduction in visual analog scale and tendon thickness in 38 patients after 3 injections polidocanol at the 2-year follow-up. Carsten Knobloch published several papers about neovessels and polidocanol. He recommends the injection from the medial side with power Doppler-guided control not to irritate the sularis nerve. At least sclerosing neovessels is not a first-line option, and this therapy addresses experts with a high experience in diagnostic ultrasound in cases of chronic mid-portion tendinopathy. Concerning the use of hyaluronic acid, I would like to show you 2 studies. The first study by Nils Leinen compares 2 hyaluronic acid injections versus 3 extracorporeal shockwave therapy in a randomized controlled study with 62 enrolled patients. He concluded that 2 peritendinous hyaluronic acid injections showed greater in treatment success in Achilles mid-portion tendinopathy compared to standard ESWT. But his study does not show long-term results. The primary efficacy criterion was changed from VISA A score to the percent change in VES compared to the baseline at 3 months post treatment. According to what we know about the time-dependent effect of the shockwave therapy, another scoring after 6 months post treatment could have changed these results. The study of Marco Foley in a design of a prospective study explores the efficacy and safety of 3 hyaluronic acid injections with a total of 71 tendons, including 34 Achilles tendons once a week over 3 weeks. He saw a significant reduction in VES scale from baseline was observed in Achilles, patella, and lateral elbow tendinopathies. So overall, there seems to be a low evidence level for hyaluron injection for Achilles tendinopathy. At the very end, I would like to show you 2 more reviews regarding injection therapy. A systematic review by Mr. Gross published in 2013 in Foot and Ankle with 312 enrolled Achilles tendons explored different injectable substances such as platelet rich plasma, prolotherapy, high volume injection, and corticosteroids. The conclusion is that the literature surrounding injectable treatments for non-insertional Achilles tendinosis has variable results with conflicting methodologies and inconclusive evidence concerning indications for treatment and the mechanism of the effects on chronic degenerated tendons. The last review I want to show is by Mrs. Carney about injection therapies for Achilles tendinopathy. A total of 732 patients were included in 18 trials. Every kind of injection therapy was contained except hyaluronic acid. The conclusion is that there is insufficient evidence from randomized controlled trials to draw conclusions on the use of injection therapies for treating Achilles tendinopathy. In summary, there is no evidence for injection therapy in Achilles tendinopathy except low evidence for hyaluronic acid, but more RCTs are here needed. There's a contraindication for corticosteroids because of a higher risk of tendon damage and rupture. So if we summarize all treatment options, the most successful mixture is eccentric loading and heavy slow resistance training combined with shockwave therapy. And this is the most promising mixture. It is activity modification, shockwave therapy, eccentric loading, or heavy slow resistance training. So my take home message is that the insertional and the mid-portion tendinopathies of Achilles tendon have good options for conservative treatment. The most evidence showed have to be instructed for activity modifications. All those regenerative methods like ESWT, EMTT, and low-level laser therapy are safe, non-invasive, and well-tolerated. Injection therapies can be a final strategy before surgery is needed. You should avoid cortisones and fluoroquinolones because of danger of tendon damage. And last but not least, would like to announce a new book about Jobber therapy and tendinopathy by Dr. Ulrich Dreisilker. Dr. Dreisilker is a pioneer in Jobber therapy in Germany and accompanied this therapy from the very beginning. He is one of the founders of the German Society of Jobber therapy and wrote many books and papers about ESWT. As far as I know, this book will be released in some weeks, and I recommend you this book for more information. And I thank you very much for your attention. So we have questions and answers.
Okay, thank you, first of all, Martin, for the excellent presentation. And I've seen there have been already two or more coming in from the questions. So one is effects of shockwave in Haglund deformity, which goes with Achilles tendopathy.
Yes, if you have a Haglund exostosis, it depends on if this Haglund exostosis did make any deterioration on the ventral side of the Achilles tendon. If there are bigger partial ruptures, it will be not easy to treat with shockwave therapy. But before surgery is done, I would try to applicate shockwave therapy, because also there's a good chance to get better. But the results are depending on the degree of partial ruptures on the ventral side of the Achilles tendon that is close to the Haglund exostosis. So I have one more question. Are there differences regarding ESWT and eccentric exercise in insertional and non-insertional tendinopathy? Very good question. Indeed, there are some differences. First, I want to say that there's evidence for both localizations. In case of an insertional tendinopathy, the eccentric exercise should not contain too much dorsal extensions. A so-called floor level training is recommended to avoid irritations of the tendon with a posterior tuberculum. The other modalities for eccentric loading stay the same. The settings for shockwave therapy are the same for insertion and mid-portion, but the prospect of success is higher in the mid-portion tendinopathy. Well, for me, I believe that as a matter of principle, the insertional tendinopathies with calcifications are more difficult than those without calcifications. I have another question. Is there evidence for both techniques, radial and focused shockwave therapy in Achilles tendinopathy? This is a question I always hear after a talk like this. Very good question. Both techniques, radial and focused shockwave therapy, are effective in the treatment of Achilles tendinopathy. Both types show good evidence. But the way I see it after 22 years of clinical practice is that the application of focused shockwave is much more convenient for the patient, especially in insertional areas. I use both techniques, but I use radial shockwave therapy just for muscular disorders or in combination with focused shockwave therapy for a sort of a myofascial co-treatment. Okay. Another question is about shockwave therapy and partial ruptures and the mid-portion area. I see someone wants to know where's the cutoff size in rupture level for treating a mid-portion tendinopathy with shockwave therapy. Okay, so for my case, I'm treating partial ruptures until 50 till 60% of the diameter. In cases of higher graded ruptures, I recommend for adding a long walker for some weeks according to the clinical symptoms, but I see no contraindication to try the shockwave therapy before they go to the operation theater. So another question, if eccentric loading is recommended in case of partial ruptures. Well, from my point of view, there's no contraindication. I would not recommend eccentric loading in cases of bigger partial ruptures. And I advise patients to do those exercises very carefully, not adding a weight at the beginning. Same is for heavy, slow resistance training. So are there any other questions?
I've seen another one. Don't use shockwave on partial tear. What thoughts on EMTT on this? So it's, I think you have had a similar one already.
So okay, but where's the problem to use shockwave therapy in case of partial ruptures? When you see, if you treat a chronic Achilles tendinopathy with a swelling in the midportion area, or a chronic non-insertional achillotendinopathy, you always will do an MRI before you go to further treatment. And the MRIs, in many cases, show beginning partial ruptures. So there is no reason not to treat them with extracorporeal shockwave therapy. There is one study from Jan-Dirk Rompe, and he showed that if you use a very high energy flux densities, more than 0.3 millijoule per square millimeter, there is a danger of damaging the tendon with too high energies. But I think you all are very well informed, and you don't use such high energy levels. So at the end of the day, for me, there is no contraindications except those patients when the partial ruptures is more than, for me, 60%. Then I will show this patient to a good foot and ankle surgeon.
Okay, I'm just looking if we find some more interesting. Okay, there's a question about protocols for focus and radial. So perhaps you can find some words about the difference about focus and radial shockwaves.
Sorry if I interrupt. Mrs. Wilson, Jennifer Wilson asked me, can you use EMTT over 60% rupture? See, Mrs. Wilson, the difference is, we have so much evidence-based literature regarding shockwave therapy, and we are just beginning to collect RCTs for EMTT. So if you ask me for the safety of this therapy, there's much more experience in using ESWT than in EMTT in such high percent ruptures, okay? Sorry, Olaf.
Actually, I lost the question because it was running away. Just a second. Oh, it was a typical one about the treatment protocols about radial and focused shockwave therapy. But I don't find it right now in the chat, but there was...
I see a question from Jamal B. Amongst these three winners, which of them is the top most treatment used in Achilles tendinopathy? See, so very good questions. The most literature, let's say me in this way, the most evidence-based literature we have to the shockwave, we have in shockwave therapy. There's no other therapy that is so highly citated and published like shockwave therapy. So I always would treat in this region where the most of the papers are, because you have the most safety for your treatment if you look at the literature. So I would always recommend shockwave therapy and indeed eccentric loading. And there's
a lot more. There's a question about, can you give us treatment protocols? Okay, but this one for radial and focused shockwave therapy.
For Achilles, yes, Mr. Muir, I showed you the standard settings according to the guidelines of the ISMSD and the Digest group. So if you want, you can write me an email and I can send you this recommendations for your treatment settings. So there is no problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay, there was another one, but I think it's a little bit on the top, over the top. It's, I wanted to ask a question. I'm not mistaken, the presentation said that ESWT increase neovascularization, while hyaluronic acid injection decrease neovascularization. Both therapies seems to be effective. So which mechanism actually works for Achilles tendinopathy? This is a quite long one, and I don't know if you have a...
Olaf, can you repeat the question, please?
The question was, the guy, Henry, asked, if I'm not mistaken, the presentation said that ESWT increases neovascularization.
Yes, this is my...
Yes, this was part one. And then on the... And the mechanism actually works for Achilles tendinopathy.
Well, I don't believe that hyaluronic acid decreases neovascularization. That is, sclerosing therapy with polidocanol is sclerosing neovessels. See, you have to differentiate. The neovessels are the bad cops, and the neovascularization are the good cops. The neovessels are the vessels with a very low flow velocity. And this, those vessels are transporting inflammation. And the neovascularization are vessels with a mucosa, and they have a very fast flow velocity. And those are the good vessels. So the bad vessels are the neovessels, and the neovascularization is what we want. I hope that it's sort of clear now. Okay?
Okay. So,
my opinion about mesotherapy in management. Well, I don't use mesotherapy, and I haven't found any literature in PubMed, so I can't give any statement for mesotherapy.
Okay, there's next question about protocols, but you already answered this one.
Okay, this is an important question. What time frame would you intimate shock therapy if they were on fluoroquinolones? 4 to 6 weeks are too short. I would wait for 3 months. 3 months, okay?
Directly post-surgery. Okay, there's another one. Any role for ESWT directly in post-surgery for a complete rupture in the rehabilitation protocol?
Any role for directly in post-surgery? Yes, there are. Indeed, we have pre-surgery protocols and we have post-surgery protocols. Carsten Knobloch, he had a lecture about ESWT in complete ruptures in the International Foot and Ankle Surgery Congress last year here in Augsburg. So if you ask Carsten Knobloch, and you can direct the email to my person, and I will send to him, he can give you all the material for complete ruptures in the rehab protocol, okay?
Okay. There's another... Okay, this one was another one I've seen before. Is there any evidence or clinical experience about deep vein thrombosis risk while treating trigger points of the calf?
No, not at all. This is, we have no thrombogenesis caused by shockwave therapy. This is, there's no single paper in the world. It does not exist. But I wouldn't recommend to do shockwave therapy if there is a fresh thrombosis in the lower limb. Okay?
Okay, then there's another one about application protocol. If you hold the applicator static or if you're moving about the lesion. So,
can I go to the slide, Olaf?
Yes, you can. Or give me the number and I'll try to find it.
Okay, I will show you. There's one slide and I have it in a second. Hang on.
Okay.
Hang on. I will show you because this is the best answer I can give. So the device, okay, so we have it. So, okay, hang on one more second. So, yes. So I wanted to show you this pictures, because I always mark the pain street. This is the area I palpate the tendon in the mid portion, or in this case in the insertional area, and I'm treating this street along up and down from both sides, from the medial and from the lateral sides and from the upper side. So I have three directions where I move with the device. Okay, and I do this in the mid portion area, and I also I'm cruising through the insertional area where the pain spots are. But before I treat, I always mark the spots where the pain is. Okay.
Okay, there's another one. Okay, now it's in English as well. There was a Spanish one. What is your opinion about the use of radial wave with high power laser? So radial shockwave therapy combined with high energy laser.
Yes, there are indeed some so-called combined studies, and maybe it makes sense to add low level laser therapy to radial shockwave therapy. That may lead to an abbreviation of the symptoms. But there is not much randomized control studies. But I see no contraindications not to combine this.
Okay.
Okay.
It's getting more and more silent in the chat. There was someone asking for your email address, but I think it's in the presentation or not. I've not seen it.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of thanks. I think I can just agree. It was a great presentation, Martin.
Thank you very much.
And
I appreciate it being here.
Thank you. So I think Uli Dreisecke is asking a question. What about the age of patients? So
which patient?
I don't know. I just seen the question from Uli.
I reported about many patients this evening. Maybe you mean the patient that I demonstrated about the German high jumper. Okay, this was the lady was in the age of 53, and the chair and the sports teacher, she was in the age of 47. I think you meant those both patients. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right. I think now we are through.
I think, thank you. So we go offline right now. Thanks for all of you for watching this. And you can watch the recording as well on shockwavetherapy.com. So thank you, Martin, again, and goodbye.
Thank you, Olaf. Thank you to our participants, and have a good evening. Bye-bye.
Bye.